Have you ever thought there was an advantage to being the faster car? How much faster? If there is an advantage to being the faster car, is there an upper limit to that? Like, how fast is too fast? Have you ever wondered what is the average ET at one of these bigger money bracket races? Have you ever wondered, like, what ET range yields the highest win percentage out of all of the ET ranges? If you've ever wondered this, we're going to cover that and much, much more information in today's video when we dive way deep into way too many statistics about big money bracket racing. So, way more information than you ever thought you might want to know coming up next. So, stay tuned. But before we dive into some deep statistical analysis, let's be sure that we thank today's video sponsor, which is Get'em Performance. Get'em not only provides all American-made, all billet aluminum, top-of-the-line custom carburetors, but they couple that with the absolute highest customer service and tech support that you could ever imagine. I have had numerous conversations with Trevor and the team over at Get'em, and trust me, you guys, these guys know their stuff. I think what is equally, if not even more impressive than these beautiful carburetors is their passion and customer service level that they provide to their customers. These guys literally get on an airplane and fly to a racetrack to meet you, to help you one-on-one with your specific combination to get the absolute maximum performance and consistency out of your combination. That is just freakishly amazing. If you are at all interested in bolting one of these super trick carburetors onto your hot rod, and you want to be backed by the best customer service in the business, consider visiting Get'em Performance's website, which is linked down in the description. Their phone number is also there. Give Trevor a call. You guys will not regret it. And do not forget to use discount code GALLSTAR5. Save yourself 5% off of your purchase and get yourself more horsepower and more consistency with Get'em Performance. Now, let's get into today's video. All right, guys, we're about to dive into this spreadsheet that I made. I hope you guys are okay with looking at some data here because that's mostly what this video is going to be. But I got this idea for this video when I was listening to all these big money bracket races that are just happening this month, like one after another, after another, after another, after another. I think there's 5 weeks in a row of this, and I was just listening and I was like, man, faster cars seems to just keep turning on the win light. And I'm like, I wonder if there's something to that, you know, because I always feel that I perform better as a racer when I am chasing the other guy, right? Because the action happens out in front of you on the track, and I always consider that an advantage. And I thought, you know, is that an actual advantage, and do the statistics actually back that up? So that's kind of what spawned the idea for this video. And then as I started collecting data, I just wanted to know more and know more and know more, and that's how we got here. So I should actually preface this by saying I race a dragster, and what we're gonna be looking at today is information about the dragster side of the class only.
What?
Because this would have been twice as much work to include a door car side of this.
But door cars win all the big races.
That's a whole nother video potentially. So this is only dragsters. We're gonna be looking at 3 different big money bracket races, round one of dragsters.
Dad, you need to do door cars.
I basically took down all the data of what all of these guys were dialed and who turned the wind light on, what lane they were in, lots of data. Let's hop in the spreadsheet and get a look. All right, so as you can see here, I've actually analyzed 3 different races: the SFG Million, the Spring Fling Million, and of course the Great American Bracket Race Million.
Dual cars win all of these races.
This was actually the round one of the 40K warm-up race because the actual million had not happened when I compiled this data. So this is SFG Million, Spring Fling Million, and then the 40K race at the guaranteed million. So this is what we're looking at. Average dial. So this is Dragster round one, average dial at the SFG million, 475.5. You head on over to the Spring Fling, 471.5. And then at the Great American Race, 466.1. So you can see, like, as the summer went on, the cars got faster, right? The low dial at each of these races, 419, 399 at the Fling, 401 at the Great American Bracket Race. And then the high dial, of course, at the SFG Million, 565. At the Spring Fling, there was a dragon. So there is a 640 dial that happened, and then at the Great American Race, a 542. As you can see over here on the right, I kind of combined all of the races, so all of the data from all three put together, 471 was your average dial, and then 399 all the way up to 640. That is the spread of the dragster class. Looking over here at the left and right lane wins, this was just a bit of side information. I had the data, I figured I'd be interesting to know. 52% of the time, the left lane got the win light on at the SFG Million, but then you look at the Fling, 55%, that's a 10% swing. 55 versus 45, the right lane picks up the win at the Spring Fling Million. I thought, wow, that's crazy. I don't think there's anything to make of that. It just kind of blew my mind. And then, of course, it was about 50-50 over at the Great American Race. So total, it ended up being about 50-50, as expected. But here's where the data started to get a little bit interesting. This is with the average winning dial and the average losing dial. So let's look at the SFG Million. 473 was the average dial of all of the winners round one, and 478 was the average dial of all of the losers. Now, if you look at this, the winning guys are just slightly faster than the average, and the losing guys are just slightly slower than the average. And what's crazy about that is that same situation carries throughout all three of these races. Look at the Fling. 470 is the winner versus a 471 average. 473 is the average loser versus a 471 average. 464 versus a 6, and a 68 versus a 6. It holds true throughout. So on average, the cars that win round one are slightly faster than the average dial, and the cars that lose are slightly slower than the average dial. So this is the first little tidbit of information here that leads me to believe that there may actually be statistical proof to the faster car having a slight advantage in a bracket race. So that's what we're looking at here. I thought it was interesting. Moving on, the faster car wins and the slower car wins. So this is actually the amount of win lights they turned on at the SFG Million. 51% of the races were won by the faster car. 48% of them were won by the slower car. 53 for faster at the Spring Fling, 46. And then 55 and 45. Wow. 55% of the time the faster car turned on the win light at the Great American Race. So that is crazy. Another little tidbit of information here that leads me to believe the faster car has a slight advantage out there. And then down here is just some information I needed for some equations and stuff, but this is the spread. So of course there were heads up races at all of these events, and that is of course a zero spread. And then the maximum spread that was seen was an 81 at the SFG Million. At the Spring Fling, 1.78. There was a dragon at the Spring Fling Million, and it's almost a 2 second spread. And then of course 0.75 seconds was the maximum spread at the Great American Bracket Race. So you can see here kind of all of the combined data from all of the races. That is that. Of course, we had to take it to the next level. So looking at this next chart, I was actually curious, now with all this data, is there a range of ETs that turn on the win light a higher percentage of the time than other ET ranges? So you can see here on the left, I have all of the ET ranges kind of laid out, like the 4 second up to 419, 420 up to 429, and here's your 430s, your 440s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 20s, all the way down. You can see the ones that I grayed out, I didn't actually plot on the chart just because there's not enough data here. I mean, not the super, super fast guys and the super, super slow guys. There weren't enough of them to actually like I didn't feel like it was really valid to put them on the chart because there's just so few data points there. So I actually just plotted the 430 cars up to the 520 cars, and that is what's shown over here on this chart. This is the win percentage versus what they're dialed in at. And what I see here is, you know, when you're a really, really fast car, your win percentage is down a little bit, but then you get a little bit slower in the 440s, you got a little bit over half the win lights are coming on. 450s, a little bit better. 460s, better yet. 470s went down a little bit. 480s, we're getting slower now, and they're not quite at 50%. 490s, not doing good. 50 cars, holy, what? I can't explain this. I was looking into this, and I was like, This is like an outlier or something I can't explain here, because what I was kind of seeing was a curve here, like 52, like it's kind of like an arch that comes down, but this 50 class here, it just doesn't make sense to me. So I guess what I kind of deduct from looking at this chart is that it looks like, based just off of win percentage, that 450s, 460s, the faster side of the field, you know, based off of versus like 480s, 490s, seems to do a little bit better. But it wasn't good enough. I had to take it further than that. So down here, this is where it really starts to get interesting to me anyways. This is where we're starting to look at the actual spread of each race. So we'll look at races that have a really, really small spread, like they're like heads-up races or really close to heads-up races, or have a huge, huge, huge spread. And then we'll look at everything in between too. So that's kind of what this data shows here at the bottom of the chart. Of course, these are your heads up races all the way up to having a 500th spread. So all of these races, there were 65 of them that happened throughout all my data, were really, really, really close to heads up races. So as you move up this table, the spread is a little bit more, a little bit more, a little bit more. And then way at the top, I started bumping it up a little bit. 30 to a 45 spread. So this is approaching a half of a second spread. This is getting to be a pretty big spread. And then the really, really big spreads, I just grouped them all into one line here on the chart, just so there was a lot of data. So you can see how often the fast car wins, how often the slow car wins, but then I put it in graphical form down here. So this is what I really wanted to show you guys. So let's look at this chart. I should probably relabel this bottom axis here because this just says 05, which is 500s, but what it actually is showing here is all the data that is 500s or less, right? So this is heads up races all the way up to having 500s of a spread. So these are all races that are either heads up or really, really close to heads up. And the orange bar is the slower car winning, and the blue bar is the faster car winning. So you can see here, it's about a coin flip, and that makes sense to me. It's almost 50-50. The reason that makes sense to me is because a heads-up race or a nearly heads-up race is really easy for both drivers to see. Even if you're slightly slower, you can still see that race really, really well. So this makes sense to me why having such a small amount of spread would be about a coin flip. It'd be about 50-50. Moving up here to having a little bit more spread, you can see actually the slower cars did quite a bit better here, 62% versus 37%. So I guess if you're going to be a slower car, you want to just be about somewhere between 6 and 10 hundredths slower based off of this data. So then, of course, you get up here, this would be 11 to 15 hundredths. It's about a coin flip here. So I'm not sure. Down here on this left side of this chart, when close races are happening, I don't think either driver really has an advantage or a disadvantage. I think it's mostly going to be a coin flip here on these first three bar graphs here. Now, let's go all the way to the right side. This is where we're having huge spreads. We're having a fast car and a slow car on the track, and there's a huge spread between the two. What you see down here at the 0.45 mark, this is approaching a half of a second spread. You can see it's about 50-50 again. It's a coin flip again. Down here at the real, real huge, huge, huge spreads, the faster car won most of those. But again, on this extreme side, I probably would not deduct much information from that. I don't think that... There's probably a disadvantage to being the slower car, But even when you're the faster car on that huge of a spread, yeah, it's happening in front of you, but you guys, it happens so fast. It's like, I don't really want to look at these two or this side of the chart, and then I can kind of see what's going on over here. But what I really want to draw your attention to here is the middle of the chart. So look at this 020 spread. 63% of the time, the faster car won. 025, 57% of the time, the faster car won. And then 030, 70% of the time, the faster car won. So this middle section of the chart is basically outlining races where they're not heads up, and they're not a huge spread. It's like medium amount of spread, right? So what we're looking at here is races where a faster car is having a really, really nice view on the slower car, and he can see that race happening in front of him. And at the same time, the slower car is kind of having trouble seeing the race because he's got to look behind him. So what we're looking at here is an advantage to the faster car and a disadvantage to the slower car happening at the same time. That's what's happening at the middle of this chart. And that's kind of what I wanted to point out to you guys here. So with this information so far that we looked at with the average dials and win light percentage, we've kind of decided that, yeah, maybe there is something to being the faster car. Now with this win percentage versus dial spread range, what spread range yields the most win lights for the faster car? I'm gonna call it on these three middle parts of the chart. So this is gonna be your 15 to your 30 spread. So if there is advantage to being a faster car, how much faster do you want to be? 015 to 030. That is the answer based off of these bits of data here and this analysis that we have going on. So with that being said, now we know, we're saying it's an advantage being a faster car. We know that we want to be faster by about 15 to 30 hundredths. Now let's look, what dial do we need to be at to maximize the probability of us landing in that situation and looking at that specific spread? I want to figure out, where do I need to be dialed so that I can be looking at a race that is 15 to 30 slower than me? That's what I want to try to maximize, the number of occurrences that that happens. So with that being said, I made another chart. This chart here is the dial occurrences that happened on all of the laps that I went through the live stream and typed them all in. This is what we got here. So what we're looking at here is all of the dials across the bottom, and then the blue line going up is the number of times that that dial actually happened. So you can see here on the 399 car, it happened one time, right? You go way over here on the right, 640, there was one dragon. That happened one time, that dial happened. So let's pick one in the middle here. 451, this happened nine times. Let's get here a really tall one. Let's look at this. 461, that was dialed 22 times. You go over here, 483 was dialed 21 times. So then we can kind of normalize this data. We get a little bit of a bell curve going on. And you can kind of see the black line here is the average dial out of all of these. So 471 being the average dial. Let's put that 015 to 030 spread on top of that average dial, because that's where the most opponents are going to be. The most cars are going to be right in the middle on top of that average, right? So if you take that 015 to 030, that's a 15 total spread, and you chop that in and put 471 right in the middle, what you end up with is this yellow window right here. So this yellow window is 463.5 up to 478.5, that is a 15 spread. This is the single 15 spread on the normalized chart where you would have the most cars inside of that window. Does that make sense? Now, if I want to be looking at that race from a 015 to an 030, me being faster vantage point, then I need to be dialed over here on the green line, which is 448.5. So from 448.5, I'm exactly 15 faster than a 463.5, and I'm 30 faster than a 478.5. So what that means is I am looking at the 015 to the 030 spread range, the maximum amount of times that I'm at the racetrack. So I'm trying to put that window where there is the most other cars. So in order to actually put myself into that most advantageous situation the most often, based off of this specific data, and if money was no object and there was no other factors other than just you're doing big money bracket racing with only dragsters on great racetracks, this makes sense. This is what I do. I want to be 448. That would, statistically speaking, be your best option. Money was no object. Would I actually build a car that would go 448 or like 450, something like that? I don't know. Maybe. Depends. If I could build it and, you know, take timing out of it or something to make it slower for all of the other races that I do that are not at big money bracket races where I'm racing against slower door cars. I'm not just racing against dragsters, or I'm racing on tracks that maybe aren't quite as good. Maybe there's marginal track surfaces, traction isn't as good. There's a lot of other factors where there may be reasons why I don't want to be that fast. Those would be other things that I would need to factor in. But just based off of this data here, where we're talking about big money bracket racing, these specific events, running the dragster side of the class, I think this kind of points out the best place for you to be in order to make it to that final round. But let's be real, and I know you guys will leave it down in the comments, the dragsters don't end up winning these anyways. It's door cars that win pretty much every one of these events.
Door cars!
What do you think about this whole analysis? Was it too much? I told you it was more than you ever wanted to know. If you liked this video, please womp on the like button. And if you dislike this video, womp twice on the dislike button. Consider subscribing if you're new here. We have weekly bracket racing content. Visit the Gallstar TV swag shop to support the channel and support the creation of more videos just like this one. I will see you guys in the next one. This is a non-standard outro. That's not normally what I say, is all that stuff. Goodbye.
Support the day's sponsor. Get 'em performance. Use this comp for Godstock 5. See you in the next video. Later.